Hi, today we are going to review market research, segmentation, target marketing, and positioning. In other words, STP, segmentation, target, and positioning. Market research is a concept that, although we'll present it in this context in terms of trying to find out what group best to communicate and to approach for our sport product consumption, it really is the idea that research and data makes better decisions. We can use that throughout our process, and not just in marketing, but in every aspect of business relationship. For instance, you did research when you decided what college you wanted to go to. A company is going to do research when they hire a person. They're going to review their resume and CV. They are going to interview the person, often a number of times. They're going to do a background check, maybe look at social media aspects. So when you think about market research or just research, it really helps us make better informed decisions. It minimizes the risk of a bad decision. In order to make better decisions, or as Mullen says, informed decisions, organizations and people need information. They need data. They need to be able to collect information from multiple sources, including and especially if the data points to one direction. Oftentimes we'll see data that conflicts. One data might suggest that we offer one type of food in a concession stand. Another piece of data may suggest that we do not offer that. So the more information we get, the better we're able to weigh the different aspects of the data, apply a criteria, and make a much better decision. Having a decision made just by our gut instinct or based by a historical perspective really doesn't help anymore because of the changing environment. The economics is very different. The competitive nature is very different. The motivation and behavior of our consumers is very different. So we need to make sure that we collect accurate and timely information about consumers and potential consumers. We want to set up a protocol where we're not just collecting the information once. We're continually looking at our internal environment, our external environment, to make sure that those decisions are best applied. For instance, if we look at a decision is made because internally we have a core competency. Maybe we have a very special person with a direct relationship to a client, and we've built a decision on that relationship. Well, if the person gets sick for a long term or decides to leave our organization, we then don't have that strength. Is it still the best decision to continue with that path? Maybe, maybe not. So we look at this basic design of a market information system. And a market information system really is this idea that we're going to look at, collect, analyze a continual loop of this information. We're going to look at external data, data that affects the competitive nature, all of us, unemployment, the economy, different governmental actions. We can look at internal data, data based our strengths and weaknesses. Maybe it's secondary data that's collected not for our use, but is easily and readily found within the halls of our organization. That's going to be put in some sort of analytic place where we collect it and analyze it and continually update these different data points so that we're able to get the information when we need it and analyze it and make decisions and continually look for feedback to make sure that that is the best decision that we can. We need to collect information from three general sources. General market data. Market data such as demographics, the size of the market, consumer habits and behavior. Individual consumers, individual demographic and psychographic information is important. And data on competitors. So these external environs is a very important place to begin our discussion. General market data. When we look at designing and segmenting different areas, we want to take a look at the overall market that we're talking about. How many consumers are in there? What type of consumers are in this critical trading radius? And we can break these out or segment it by gender, by age, by income level, by purchase behaviors. If we see a certain segment of the market maybe 50% of our market purchases tickets on the first of every month, then we're going to be led to the decision that our advertising should be on the end of the month previous to it. So people are in the idea and they know that they're going to be spending that money, that they'll spend it on us. So we can look at purchase behaviors, consumption patterns. Do people buy multiple tickets at once? If we look at a sizable portion of our target audience and we find out that 23% of our audience buys tickets to three or more games, that becomes a segment that we can go on. It's not based on demographic or based on geographic or age or anything along those lines. It's a purchase behavior. So we may want to look at that 20%, 23%, which is a very sizable portion, and offer additional incentives for them to buy three tickets. Now they can buy four. Maybe we give a ticket plan for four tickets, which are the price of three and one. Or if you buy five tickets, you get a parking pass or a discount on parking in a better lot. We can look at the consumption patterns in a way of breaking down. Maybe we look at our running shoe company and we look at multiple different options that we have, and we have 53% of our consumers buy a high-end running shoe because they're very competitive. Now we're looking at a different market than the group that buys running shoes for fashion or maybe for walking. We also want to look at data for future trends, and by data we can look at participation levels over the past 3 or 4, 5, 10 years to see how the market is moving over time, and we can extrapolate and see what our best guesses would be for the future. One of the most critical pieces of information that we need, and oftentimes difficult to collect and to keep, unfortunately, is information on past, present, and future customers. If we're a small organization, we need to be able to collect names, addresses, email addresses, phone numbers, organism. How can we reach them? How did they purchase in the past? For instance, we may have a one-time event that's a yearly event. Maybe we have a particular 5K road race that we run. We collect information from last year, and we've run this for 10 years, and we kind of keep the previous year's information on hand, so we'll send out the brochure and an email to them, but we don't keep anything previous to them. We're missing out on an awful lot of potential customers. Maybe this is our 10th year, and we had a runner go for the first 8 years participate in this event. Last year, they weren't able to participate because maybe they had a wedding or they had a graduation. They had something specific that day that they could attend. If we don't collect the information and store it over time, we're going to miss out on that information because they didn't participate last year. So we need to make sure that we collect things. How did they use the information? What media did they use? If we know where they go to get their information, maybe they watch it from ESPN or Sky Sport or Channel 82 News, whatever the media used, whatever website they go to, we collect that. Now we know that we can advertise there and be able to be presented in front of our consumer without a lot of waste coverage. Again, that information makes our decision much better, much more effective. We know where our customer is looking for the information. If we put it there, we can very effectively and efficiently use our advertising budget without wasting it. We want to collect information on our data and keep this information up to date. What are their price lists? What are the lines? How are they used in different areas? What are they doing? What are their strategies? Are they aggressive? Like a Nike is very aggressive and they try to competitively win in every product category that they're at, or do they serve a different audience? Maybe like a Saucony or a Fila, where it's a very specific niche market, but they're going for a very high quality or very competitive marketplace. We can plan for and adjust and think about the reaction that our competitors are going to do based on our decisions. If we know that we're going to do an action and we know and anticipate the reaction from our competitor, that makes our decision much better. We're not going to make a decision that allows the competitor to come back against us very strongly. For instance, if you're playing a football match and you know that if you kick the ball long, that the other team is sitting back waiting for it and they'll take the ball and drive on it and score a goal, you're not going to do that pattern. You're going to dribble the ball up more often. Internal data sources, sales records, inquiries, accounting records, information that we have within our organization, information that we've collected. For instance, if we're having a decision that we want to decide on some concessions, what type of hot dog do we want to offer? Maybe we have brand A and brand B, and we've sold both in the past. We can go down to our sales records and see which one sold more. Maybe we had brand B last year and we sold 50,000 units, and brand A the year before we sold 40,000. One thing that we can look at, sales records. Now we have to be cautioned because that doesn't tell us the entire story. We want multiple points of data. If we just look at that, we'd say, well, you know, brand B sold 50,000, brand A sold less. We have to go with brand B. People like brand B better. Not necessarily. We should look at attendance records. Maybe last year we had 100,000 people visit our games, but the year before when we sold 40,000 hot dogs, we only had 40,000 people there because we had construction on our stadium and bad weather and multiple different factors that we had more people show up the other year. Sure, we sold more, but the percentage that we sold was dramatically less than the year before. So we need to get multiple data sources to really flesh out our decisions to find specifically what answer we want to have. Some secondary data sources. Secondary data sources is information collected for different questions. They're answering different questions, such as census reports or information on the market size. How many females are in your market? How many international students are at your college campus? How many people live on campus versus off campus? How many males versus females? All that information is collected for different reasons, not necessarily to answer our specific question of how many people are going to purchase hot dogs or how many people are going to get to our college football game. But it's information that we have available to us, and we're very easily able to collect it. And I expect us to collect this information for all of our case studies and our semester-long project. This is information that's out there that we need to analyze. It's not written for us, but we need to be able to take that information and apply it to our specific question in order to really help us make a decision. For instance, if we're trying to get more students to our college football match, and we decide a program because we want to go after males because our point of view might be that males like soccer much better than females. However, the data shows that we are 95% female on our college campus and only 5% male, and those males, if we follow up additional information, aren't interested in sport, then our decision to target males is completely off base. The data says something else. And when you go in front of your decision maker, when you get your internship and when you get your jobs and you make a recommendation, it should be supported by data. When you make your recommendations to me, in all of our work, it needs to be supported by data. So going to a decision maker and saying, you know, I want you to spend $10,000 on this idea, we're going to target males, he's going to ask, why did you make that decision? If you go in, I think we should target females because they're 95% of our college community and they're more inclined to like sport, that makes the decision maker open up, yes, I agree with you, here's $10,000, let's do that. We can find that from trade associations, scholarly publications, you know, journal articles that write on different aspects to it, gender differences, performance, ability or spectator involvement or participant involvement and media and social media and all these different areas. There's scholarly publications out there that have done this research. We need to find it and apply it to our decisions. Secondary sources like a Scarborough or a Nielsen or an SBRNet or American Sports Data, information that collects based on overall information done differently. National Sporting Goods Association does a tremendous job, and you can research them via their website, and they'll show participation levels per sport trending over multiple years. If we want to know, we're a brand new running shoe company, who do we want to go after? And we see that 87 million people in the United States walk on a traditional basis. Maybe we want to design our running shoe for that walking or that recreational runner as opposed to an elite athlete. There's many more people in that area. We also want to look at primary data sources. Primary data sources are this idea that we're going to communicate with a specific audience. We are asking specific questions and getting research based on that. It's primary. It's going to answer our question for us. It's going to be much more, oftentimes much more expensive. It's going to take a whole lot more time to do it than a secondary data, but hopefully it answers our specific question. Communicating with the audience, what type of information do you go to? What are your media sources? Your position in the marketplace, your profile of the audience, different aspects for sponsorship, solicitation, all sorts of specific information designed for our organization. We look at different types of primary care, whether it's personal observation, maybe if we want to know what type of hot dog people like, we have two different concession stands and we offer both, and we go out and look at and observe the people when they buy it, watch them bite into it, what are their reactions. Maybe we do some sort of quick survey on site and we ask them, how do you like this? We go to the other one and do the same thing. So we observe people. One negative, and all these will have pros and cons. One negative to that, when people realize that they're being observed, their behavior changes dramatically. Another example, maybe you want to know, are your concessionaires friendly? Maybe one way that you want to increase your concession sales is to have your concessionaires be friendly so that people are more likely to open purchase. So when you go in front of them and you observe their behavior, how are they working with the customers and consumers as they come up to purchase their food? They're going to do a much better job with you watching them than they would if you're not. Most people change their behavior if they're being evaluated. Focus groups where you watch people. Maybe you give your running shoe to 10 different people and have them go for a run and then come back and ask them questions and watch them do different things. Surveys and questionnaires, whether it's on site where you do it, which is very cost effective because you don't have to pay for a different location. However, it's very biased because it's only interviewing people that have made the decision to attend your game. You're not getting people who don't want to go. So if your question is what makes you more likely to attend more games, by doing it by people at the stadium, it's going to be biased already. Mail surveys, telephone surveys, website surveys, email surveys, many of these are very cost effective and you can get them out to a lot of people. However, response rate is very low. And many people, if it's done kind of anonymous like this, may not give you true answers. Maybe they'll give you answers that you think you want to see. Video interviews, community intercepts where you go into kind of an off-site survey, panel of experts, mystery fan, or a mystery shop where you pay somebody to go through your organization. Maybe you want to find out how friendly your concessionaires are. Great, let me get somebody who has the concessionaires do not know. Maybe I pay an organization, a marketer, to come in and buy them a ticket and pay them money, and they go up and, they buy stuff from the different concession stands and they find out how friendly the people are. So we have many different areas of primary data collection, ways that we can collect information. When we look at problems in the market survey area, how many people should I survey to be accurate? In your statistics classes, if you want to be 100% accurate, you have to interview 100% of the people. What if you need to be 95% or 90% accurate? How many people then do you have to survey or interview or watch? That way, it's reliable. How dependable are your findings? In other words, can you rely on it? We did a information we're looking to find out where to do some event marketing for a cruise ship client based on number of people who went to Florida the year before, thinking that the people who go to Florida in the past few years are more likely to take a cruise that goes from Florida. We saw one city, Sheboygan, Wisconsin, 50% was our data, and we looked at it and 50% sounded too high for a city of about 125,000 people. So when we looked at it, we found out the data was actually filled up by two people, one of which went to Florida the past year. So It wasn't very reliable. We had to critically think about our data. In fact, we had to collect more data to really understand and analyze what that was. Many people recommend that demographic information, if it's not the most important aspect of your questionnaire, be placed at the end of the survey. Most people do not enjoy questions about race or religion or household income. So if you're asking questions that people may respond either with a answer that isn't true or something that they skip, now they're getting into the mindset that I can skip different answers and I don't have to answer this. So if the demographic information isn't the main purpose of the survey, we can put that at the end so they're not in that mindset of skipping questions where they'll do that continually throughout the survey. You want it to be random. If your question is about are female and male students more likely to attend a college sporting event or a sporting event, and you do it within a sport management area, now you're biased towards people who are more inclined to like sport. If you do it perhaps in a different school or in a community intercept, like the student union, where you're getting people from multiple backgrounds, now your random survey is much more applicable. You may be getting people who initially don't like going to sporting events or not like to go to many of them for the sport aspect. Maybe they like to go for social reasons, or they would go if there's a different area for them to participate in. Maybe they really like some sort of music aspect, and you find out, well, if we add some music, maybe a band or some sort of area before the match, we can have a local band come in or singers participate, and they'll go to that and then stay. If we find out a more general information, more random population, we can get that information. If we do it solely on people who want to go for the sport itself, we're not going to get that type of information. So we want to evaluate it. Is the data lying to us? Or in other words, is it indicating something that may not necessarily be the entire truth? So we want to collect the information, collect our data. Specifically, we're looking at in this chapter, how do we collect information to base our segmentation decisions? How do we look at our potential consumer base? We want to collect all this information, male, female, demographic information, age, where they live. If you look at a typical college class, we can segment our group based on many different variables, based on male, female, seniors, juniors, sophomores, freshmen, graduate students, international students, people who live in one dorm versus another dorm versus another dorm, people who live on campus or off campus, people who live in state or out of state, people who live in country or different country or different country. So we can look at completely different demographic just in a class of 20 to 40 students and really break it up. In fact, we want to look at multiple segmentations because the more we segment an area, the more specific it gets. We can look at a class of 40 students, and if we treat it as one class, one group, now we're mass marketing. We can break it up on multiple segments to the point that each individual person becomes their own segment. That might be a little bit too small to effectively market towards a group, but maybe we look at female junior seniors who live off campus. Now we're looking at a very specific market that may be able to be accessible, but the motivations and reasons may be different than a female on campus who's looking to go to a sporting event because they want to have some sort of connection to the school, whereas a junior senior may look at it as an opportunity for a social endeavor to see friends from different areas and different programs that they don't see as often. So we can look at psychographic information, your personality, your lifestyle, your psychological. When we think of psychographic, we want to think AIO, activities, interests, and opinions. What type of person are you? What are your activities, interests, and opinions? Or some behavioral aspects to it, the benefits or the usage of the product, a non-user, a heavy user, a medium user, a light user. So this idea of market segmentation, dividing large heterogeneous market, dividing your heterogeneous market, your 40-person class into more homogeneous groups of people, into more specific groups, male, female, on campus, off campus, row 1, 2, 3, 4, or a combination thereof, who have similar wants, needs, and profiles. The more targeted your group, the more exact your benefits can satisfy that want and need. If we break that 40-person group into 40 individual segments, I can target you specifically. Negative again to that is it's going to be very costly to market towards each individual person and much more time consuming. However, technology is allowing us to move that direction. When we collect information and we can put it into some sort of MIS, area market information system, we can figure out, Professor Dodds buys running shoes every 3 months. It tends to be at the beginning of a running season, and he likes these different brands, and he watches these shows, and goes on to these specific websites, and he likes to spend this amount of money, so that I can be targeted via email very specifically from a running shoe company or a retailer to very specifically do that. And technology does allow us to do that on a very micro level. However, if we're looking at more of a general mass advertising, it's difficult to have a television commercial designed for each individual person. Purpose that we want to segment is so that we can specialize, so we can focus the benefits, so we can speak in the language that the people want to hear, in the place that they want to hear it. If I'm looking at a running shoe to go long distance, I want to see information presented to me that answers that question, that provides that benefit to me. I don't want to see one that is for kids or for fashion or for sprinters, because that's not what my usage is going to be. I want to focus on most likely to buy. I may want to look at the low-hanging fruit. I may want to look at, perhaps not the low-hanging fruit, but a group that's going to spend more. Maybe my overall marketing goal isn't to sell the most running shoes, but a very specific niche. Instead of selling them for for $75, maybe I want a group that buys them for $150. So I'm going to sell less, but I'm going to focus on that audience. I want to meet the wants and needs without exhausting resources. I want to put the product, price, promotion, place, and PR in the right way. I want to make this effective. I want to identify a segment in terms of size and purchasing power. Males, females, females off campus, usage pattern. I want to look at these segments and work through them and find out how big are they and what type of purchase they are. So we're looking at multiple points of data. I want to look at how accessible they are. I want to look at, do I have the ability to reach them? Is it a target audience I've never reached before? Am I a water that's done like Evian Water that sponsors a lot of tennis matches and country club events? Do they want to go after a skateboarding event? They've never gone for that market before. They don't have that distribution network, maybe more of a C-store or a convenience store area. And they don't have the marketing background into that audience. Maybe that audience isn't responding to the Evian brand name. Certainly, if we start marketing towards kind of a more extreme sport or a youthful market or a skateboard market, if the tennis and country club market sees that, they may actually be put off by the brand then. So we want to look at, can we reach an audience without disturbing the other ones? Is it maybe we look at and identify that the Chinese market is ripe for us to expand, but we've never done it before? Now it's not accessible. We need to make a marketing decision. How do we get there? Do we make a co-branding or some sort of agreement with somebody with distribution already there, or do we invest in it? So our information may lead to additional questions that we need to be able to respond to those wants and needs. Can we get to that audience? Is it worth targeting that segment, or is it something that we really can't get to? We want to look at segmenting or breaking over this overall product potential consumer base. We can look at the state of being, state of mind, product benefits, or product usage. Four different ways for us to break out that general and market area. State of being, where do you live? A geographic area, a geodemographic, if you want to look at that area. Do you want to break out a group on campus, off campus, United States, international? We can break it up by income, education, profession, age. You know, this is more of that demographic area, a very easily group that we can figure out quantitatively by giving a survey out where people can do bubbles. Number of children, gender, sexual orientation, race, ethnicity. If we think those are important to our marketing group, then we should collect that information. If we don't think that that's important, then we should not ask that question. If sexual orientation, because that is a very difficult question for a lot of people to answer, and a lot of people may be forward with answering it, but it falls into that it's none of your business category, let's not ask it. Let's make sure that, you know, unless race or ethnicity is important, which it may be depending on the culture, if we are looking at marketing towards a specific culture, if we don't need it, then we don't need to ask it. Family status, a number of children may be important because we may want to go after a married without kids or someone with young kids or singles, because that's going to be a completely different group of people that may flow into the benefits. Your socialization, a group that has kids is going to be different than a 20 to 25 year old college student or former college student. What do you want to experience? Do you want to socialize? Are you going to a game to meet your friends, or are you going to a game because it's exciting? Are you going to a game because it's high scoring, or are you going to a game because you appreciate the beauty of it, like soccer, and the grace of a match? Is it high performance? Is it entertainment? Do you go to it because it's affordable? Many minor league or lower division sport is because it's a very affordable day out with the family. Do you do it because it's affiliation? You go because you support your community. You go to a youth soccer event or a minor league team, or you go to a 5K run because it benefits a specific charity. Where are you going? What are you doing it for? It's very important. We look at product usage, and we look at this idea of the Pareto percentage, where the 80-20 rule is that 80% of our business comes from 20% of our customers. And research supports continually that it's much easier to keep existing customers than it is to go out and buy and access and get new ones. So 80-20 rule, 80% of our business comes from 20% of our customers. 80% of our business, 80% of our revenue comes from 20%. If we look at it from a media perspective, our media is going to come from 20%, maybe our national television broadcast, as opposed to perhaps our smaller local radio or different areas. 80% of our business comes from our season ticket holders or our suites versus 80% the other bunch of our customers who are buying single game tickets. So perhaps it's easier, revenue equals markets times consumption, to get people to buy more than it is to buy new. However, we want to continue to look at people buying new so we can keep them repeat business and building for the future. Product usage. Serious runner seeks support, shock reduction, and long wear in shoes, whereas a casual user somebody might buy it for fashion or regular footwear. They're completely different audiences. Here's a segment or distribution, five market segments for golf participants. So you see a competitive nature and a description of what they do, where they purchase, how often they play, and that's 18.6 of the market, or a group that we consider players, 25.7, that has a handicap between 10 and 12. They play a lot, but we're going to differentiate them from sociables, who have handicaps a little bit higher, who often play with family, as opposed to aspires, a little bit to, or casuals. So we look at these five different categories of golf participants, and we can figure out and look at that these are completely different groups who play golf very differently. After we collect all that segmenting, we want to target STP, segment, target, position. We're going to identify the attractiveness of those different segments. We may combine those different segments. Which one are we going to target? We want to connect this to our SWOT analysis. Which ones are our strengths and weaknesses? Do they match with that target audience? Do they match with an opportunity and threat? If we see a target market that's very attractive and it has a lot of potential, and our strengths and weaknesses, it matches our strengths, we have distribution, we communicate to this target audience a lot, and we see it as an opportunity that there's going to be growth and we can enter it pretty quickly, that makes our decision much clearer. Think of it this way: we're only able to go after one target market, and for your projects, you're going after one target market. Your data has to support why you're selecting that one as opposed to the thousands of other segments that we can group and go after. If we can go after one, we have limited resources, limited advertising budget, limited human capital. We only have a certain number of hours in a week and a certain number of people that we can apply to it. Is this target size and attractive? Can we measure it? Do we have access to it? If that becomes our target, those are the decisions that we need to look at. And then our last one is positioning. How do we want to position it? How do we want to present our brand to that new target in that marketplace? How do we want people to think about our product? Do we want it to be costly or a premium band? Do we want it to be affordable or sociable? Are we going after that 20-year-old who want to go skiing and have fun and be a little bit dangerous and go out afterwards? Or are we going after families that show maybe a more gentle slope with mom, dad, and the kids skiing, and then kids having fun and mom and dad on the top of the slope, you know, breathing deep, that they can go after? Reason Trout talk about if you can't be first, be different. You want to have your own brand identity. Or you can go into Reason Reads talking about the 22 immutable laws of branding. How do you present your product? And we'll be talking about branding, and we'll be talking about this positioning as we go further, because this is really how we apply those P's, how we apply those tactics. How do we color in this diagram and this picture that we've created? We've looked at segmenting a lot and how our research can make us and force us and help us make better decisions. And those decisions, we need to defend it because we're going to a decision maker and they need to be able to trust us. And we have a small group and a small limited resource budget. We need to apply it best.